Hello? Are we recording? All right. What's up, guys? Or girls, or whoever's watching this video. If you're someone on a subway on their way to work at 6 a.m. somewhere in Europe, if you're someone who's just ate dinner and you're bored and you're at your setup chilling from the West Coast, if you're someone from the East Coast, and it's a little too late for you to be up, and you just don't know what you're doing, and you decide to watch this video. Hello. So this video, I'm gonna talk about a lot. I'm not sure what all I'm gonna talk about. I'm kind of gonna go with the flow and develop ideas as we talk. But I have some main ideas, some main points that I obviously want to bring up. If you guys saw my tweet earlier, which I assume you did, which is why you're here. I basically said that I was going to talk about why COD's in such a still place right now, why the season 2 numbers were, in my opinion, this is all in my opinion, by the way, so go ahead and get that out. Why the season 2 numbers were so low, not just because, Optic lost early or whatever, and a lot of topics that are, I guess, prevalent right now in the Call of Duty competitive scene, that are issues, especially within the community. So first off, I want to give a few disclaimers here. One, I think Black Ops 3 is a really good game. I enjoy Black Ops 3. I haven't had much success on the game in my specific career since the beginning. But no, I think the game's really good. I think Treyarch did a really good job. I know the game was obviously in development when the jetpack hate, started, and then people realized that jetpack just wasn't the way they thought Call of Duty should go. So I understand that, and but no, I think the game itself to play, I enjoy it. I enjoy playing pretty much no matter what. So definitely want to give that disclaimer out there no matter what. Second, I know this is Activision's first year at running this league. Doing this Call of Duty World League stuff. I know that it's their like first go round with everything. They're quote unquote trial, their whatever you want to call it, it's their first attempt at really trying. Do I think they're doing all that they could do? No, absolutely not. Not even close. Do I think some people care? Yeah, I do. I think there's a lot of issues surrounding why things aren't being done, which are obviously out of some people's hands. But I just feel like if you're, such a big company like that, Activision, multi-billion-dollar company, and you're saying and promising you're gonna put all this time and effort and money into esports and Call of Duty especially, then at least come in with like some general consensus of, what you're doing. And in this year, I really don't think they did. I think they came in with this idea that it was just gonna go smooth and easy, and there wasn't that many expectations they had to meet. And because they were throwing $3 million in, then it was just all gonna be good and dandy. And it just didn't go that way. I don't think anyone's really satisfied or happy with how this year has been thus far. Not that it's been a horrible year, right? But it's not been a good year. It's not been growth. By no standards has this year been growth. Like, you can't associate those two words, growth and Call of Duty Black Ops 3, at all, in my honest opinion. And I think a lot of people agree with that. But yeah, so I just want to give those two disclaimers that, one, I think this game's very good. Two, I know this is Activision's first go round. Obviously, they're not going to be perfect. So, we got that out. Now we can talk about the video or everything else. So first off, let's see, where do we begin? I want to begin with why I think Call of Duty is stale right now. And so we're not gonna talk about anything else. Just why I think the community is stale, why I think the fan base is like caring, I guess, like getting really involved in games and tournaments is really just lackluster. And a big reason of that is there's absolutely zero storylines to tell. And that's always been something that I know personally I've always been highly involved with. Obviously there was the entire, AX Nadeshot thing for a while. There was always me being, the villain and, being on the bad guys or the bad boys team or whatever it may be, and then Impact had the same ordeal. There was always, a massive story around, yo, these are the bad guys, these are the guys that are talking shit coming into tournaments, like with all this online, like like shit talking, like built up. You know, these players literally went neck and neck online. Like, you're coming into this event, you know, it's the battle of the fucking the two titans. It's always been that way, up until I would say the middle part of last year, and I guess after Champs, when Denial beat or when Denial won the event, and then I guess ever since Optic picked up Damon, and you know, all these teams have formed, and you saw a little bit of the big rivalry when FaZe made their team, and it was the FaZe versus Optic on LAN. Can Optic beat FaZe on LAN? Blah blah blah. And honestly, since then, there's really been none. There's been no storylines at all. I mean, let's just, for example, let's look at the past events, okay? Let's go to all the way back to Totino's. Absolutely no storyline there. In any part of that event. UMG South Carolina. The only storyline there was the Sony PlayStation Bluetooth malfunction. Absolutely no other story to be told except, oh, let's watch and see if the controllers can fuck up more than the other team's controllers. Season one playoffs. I mean, what really happened that was exciting, you know? I really can't name. I mean, Optic Rise went game seven. You know, that was cool, I guess. But really, like, was there any build up trash talk? Like, I mean, I guess you could ask, was Optic gonna win? You know, okay, that's not really that fun. And then you had those two, like, crown. You had the crown event and the ESWC event. I don't really think those had major success viewership wise. I mean, it wasn't really. It was just like, oh, well, Optic went to Australia, and then a few US teams went to France, and they played. Cool. And then we get back, and we had Anaheim, and yeah, I mean, it was just kind of. Again, the only storyline was, what did MLG do to fix the controller issue? Like, there was really nothing to be told about players hating each other, players fighting each other, this big, you know, thing. I don't know. For me, it's like, it's boring. Yeah. Okay. If everyone's gonna, I'm just gonna give you some insight on what the Call of Duty scene like right now is off camera. You know, players play eights, okay? They get on Skype calls. They set up eights teams. They chill. They hang out. They talk. You know, they chill in calls. They shoot shit. And they just, that's it. There's really no like it was back, you know, a few years ago where, or not even a few years ago, a year ago where, or I guess a little bit more than a year ago, but. Where, like, yo, I got on Complexity or EG. We got on, the four of us. We didn't leave our call to talk to anybody else in the scene, unless it was a very rare occasion. We got on, we played with each other, and that was it. And I think my TP made a video on this of like how the practice regimen has changed, where people are playing more like eights together than they are playing with their teams. I think he highlighted on that for a little bit, but no, that's another big thing that That's definitely a part of why there's no rivalries in Call of Duty anymore. Everybody's everyone's friend, and in my opinion, I think that's really been forced by, you know, Activision coming down hard and being like, look, we want to make this a respectable esport. You know, all this unprofessionalism, all this, you know, trash talking, making each other look bad has got to stop. And okay, yeah, obviously, like sometimes to the extent it was done was obviously too far. It was wrong, but. At the same time, like, what made Call of Duty popular to begin with? In my, or I'm sorry, let me rephrase that. What made Call of Duty esports popular? It wasn't people watching the game. I mean, it's really not. I don't think people, like, get on and go to a Twitch stream on a tournament and just say, oh, I just want to watch these guys play some high caliber, you know, sick Call of Duty action. I don't think it's ever been like that. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there's 15% of people that only watch competitive Call of Duty to watch. The gameplay itself, okay? But realistically, that doesn't make sense. If you look at our Twitter following across every single player that plays professional Call of Duty, we have the most insane Twitter fan base compared to any other game. No other game in any esport can compare to how active we are on Twitter as a community. Not even just players, fans, everything. We're like the most social media driven game title ever right now. I believe that's fact. I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's how it is right now. And that's because of the storylines. That's because of, you know, who's saying what to who? Who's bitching at who? Who's, you know, shit talking who? What's going on? Like, I want to see what's happening. There's just that's not a thing in other games. That's literally so so just specific to us, and that's what we've always thrived off of, and what's always built up drama and built up, you know, this massive just drive to know, like, yo, I gotta know what's going on, I gotta see what's happening. Yo, this guy or Aches literally called out Nate Shot, he pushed Nate Shot, like, oh shit, they're about to play. Oh wow, like, blah, you know what I mean? Like, drama alert. Look at Keemstar, for example. Like, I don't think Keemstar is a great example because he's reporting a lot of news that's not Call of Duty anymore. But, like, back in the day, like, he would literally, anything that happened in the Call of Duty scene, competitive especially, he jumped on it and it blew it up. Like, we've always been, our entire game, and I've been here since the very beginning, trust me. Like, 2008, the game was dead. 2009, the game was dead. 2010, the game was dead. 2011, it grew a little bit. And just so you know, 2011 is when Twitter began for pretty much this entire scene. But I mean, even then, like, I think my very first, or not my very first event, like my second event was MLG Dallas. It was the opener for Black Ops 1. We won it, and I don't think it had over like 20K viewers, 30K viewers. Like, it was very like small for what I think they thought it was gonna be. But no one was watching the game to watch the game, just because Call of Duty is not a game. Like, it's like, I hate to say it, but it's like, for me, when I watch, it's not as, I mean, I watch now because, you know, I want to see what teams win, and I can look more in depth to it, but I don't think it's very fun to watch just to watch. You know, it's fun to watch this team play this team, to see this player play this player, and you see how a bracket develops and how a tournament's gonna run. But as far as just watching the actual match itself, it's not that great. It really isn't. This video is probably gonna go long. I know I'm already at 11 minutes. I didn't have a timestamp. I'm probably just gonna rant for, it might be a while. It might be a thorn's thoughts, and I go on for like an hour. I haven't really, you know, planned that out. But I have a lot of like notepads I wanna touch on. Anyway, back to my point. There's no storyline in Call of Duty anymore. Absolutely none. For example, like, look, we have one picture. I'll pull up. This. I don't know who made this, but there's no big name fight or big like main story to tell. And I know Nate Shot retired, and that was obviously a big thing because he was very, very huge in our fan base. He was one of the one players that, you know, pushed his YouTube following and grew, and, you know, good for him. And he retired, and that's fine. But any player can make this. I mean, there's you know, there's crims, there's scumps, there's, you know, there's players still in this community who have massive fan bases. Parasite is one of them who, I mean, at a time was very similar to how I guess approached, you know, a match or I guess a rivalry with somebody. And it's all been just calmed down and honestly like muted by Activision, in my opinion, because they came in and they kind of forced all these rules and regulations to where it's like, yo, you can't talk shit to another player. Yo, this can't happen. There's not, this isn't allowed. And honestly, it's made the scenes stale. It's made it boring. It's made it less fun to follow. It's made it just kind of whack, in my opinion. So yeah, that's one thing I wanted to touch on, how there's just no rivalries, no storylines, no real entertainment factor behind Call of Duty right now. I mean, let's look at this past weekend. Season 2 finals. Envy played DT. Sure, it was weird that was the two teams that matched up in finals, but I mean, okay, it's like DT. Well, if Killa's on the team, like, we hope Killa wins. That'd be awesome. That'd be funny. Envy. They're an awesome org. They made a roster change a few months ago. They got like 8th at Anaheim. Yeah. Yes. Cool. You know what I mean? There's other than the actual game itself, there was no story to be told. It was just another day of Call of Duty. Another league match. It was just something, you know? But yeah, I think that's really important. I think there needs to be rivalries in our game, just because of how big our social media is, how big people follow us so closely. We stream, players stream literally 12 hours a day. Their fans are so like just nonstop in with their life. People do vlogs, people do YouTube videos, people know about them. They follow them. They don't follow their team. They follow the players on their team. And I think that's always been how Call of Duty is. And we're like, The fact that we're not utilizing that, we're not forcing that issue is so confusing to me because that is what put us on the map to begin with, you know? I think Nate put it in one of his videos, and like he was like in Black Ops 2 when me and Nate had our huge rivalry, like that was a big part of Call of Duty growing. Like, and I'm not gonna say I'm not accrediting myself because I don't think it is, but like when two players are like going neck and neck at each other, you're gonna follow it. Like, let's look at, for one second, let's step out. Let's compare Call of Duty to the WWE, okay? Do you think people are gonna watch fake wrestling, you know, just to watch it? Like, if all those guys at the end of every match, like the dude pinned him, the three count, you think it's gonna be like, oh, great match, man, well played, you got me? Like, no, that's boring. That's dumb. There's a reason the WWE does so well, is because they tell this massive story with all these, you know, characters and people and these rivalries and this guy versus this guy, and this guy hates this guy, and these three hate these three, and it's some big fight. There's a big like team over here, you know, so to speak. Like, there's just so much more to be told because people aren't just watching the fake wrestling like, oh my God, fake wrestling. Like, yeah, he's punching him, but not really. And I'm not hating, if you're a WWE fan, that's great. I'm not hating on it. I'm just comparing, like, you don't watch it to just watch the wrestling itself. That doesn't make any sense at all. And if you do, I don't know what to say. I hope you get what I'm saying in the terms of you're watching because you're following these wrestlers so closely. You're following them every week. What's happening to them? You know, the story they're telling, the development of the storyline that the WWE itself is telling. And that's why they do so well. And we're just stepping so far away from that. We're turning into just everyone being buddy buddy, where it's like we got Triple H and John Cena wrestling, and they just walk out and they shake hands. You know, they're just very smug faces. Like, okay, they wrestle. Let's say fucking John Cena wins. He pins him three count. He like does an interview, then he shakes his hand. They're like, oh, good match, Triple H. You played really well, but I got the better of you, man. Like, no, that just doesn't make sense. And I don't think, and I'm not saying there shouldn't be like humbleness and there shouldn't be respect, but there's got to be some story being told. Otherwise, our game and our scene just isn't the same. It's just not, because it's never been that way. So how do you expect to just mold it into something brand new that people are supposed to follow, which is just, oh, great competitive Call of Duty action, when it's literally, for the lifespan that I followed it, has been about the players that's playing, whether it's been top players or whatever. Just in general, the players, the brands, you know, even Optic, FaZe, like even if you take the players out, those massive orgs still have those fan bases that they want to follow their team, the players on those teams, and we just don't have that anymore. It's just, all right, we got FaZe coming up here, they're playing DT, okay, you know what I mean? It's there's not like these massive rivalries that there used to be, and that's a big problem. It's just it needs to come back, you know. And if someone, if I have to fucking get on a team and call another guy a bitch just to get something like spiking so people will tune in to watch, then hell, I'll do that. But it's like, I don't understand why everyone wants to be each other. There's two problems. Like, one, players. Everyone wants to be each other's friends, and I think that's just dumb. You're playing against these guys for money. This is your job. At the end of the day, like, you gotta beat that person to succeed. You don't hang out with them every night and be buddy buddy. Like, it doesn't make sense. It didn't used to be like that, and I don't know why it turned into like that. But yeah, that was a 20-minute topic, which I didn't mean for it to run that long. But biggest point is there needs to be rivalries in Call of Duty. There needs to be hype surrounding a match. There needs to be a story leading into the match, and there's not. And I think that's one part of why our scene is very stale at the moment, very just the same things happening over and over. Anyway, another big thing, which leads into this one, single elimination. Dumbest thing in the entire universe to be put into Call of Duty. There's multiple reasons. One being we have 19 maps and modes. So we play Breach, we play Evac, we play Fringe, we play Hunted, we play Infection, we play Redwood, we play Stronghold. I think I named like seven or eight maps. We play four different game types, all on each of those maps almost. So when you think about that, we're playing one match. Let's just think, let's add Ban and Protect. So you have 19 different maps and modes, assorted. With Ban and Protect, which is basically an unlimited, you're never gonna have the same game. Not once will you have the same map in a game in a best of seven. So the fact that we're playing single elimination like Counter-Strike does, like League does, like Dota does, like these major esports that are succeeding, when they're playing one hour long fucking game, or a best of three, regardless, like they're playing one match versus one team that they could literally spend weeks preparing for. Okay? We're going into tournaments where, especially at, let's say at a group play and you go into pool play, you could potentially play anybody and you can't prepare for that specific match. You can just get as good as you can get. And someone could do some weird ban and protect that throws you off and you're just like, wow, I just got fucked in the ban and protect and we lost the map. Now we're down in a series. We just gotta hope we come back. Like, there's too many variables, and I've said this for so long. Call of Duty has way too many variables. No other game has as many variables as Call of Duty has. And I don't want people in the comments or just replying, "Oh, League has all these champions and Dota has all these heroes and whatever." Like, no, that's not the same. Like, we have so many variables that can happen on a map in a game that one series does not define your team's skill. I could go through and list you 20 different matches, 20 probably more, from tournaments in the past 3 to 4 years that if we had single elimination, teams that got first or second, where they made 200 grand, 175 grand at champs, would have lost round one and got top 16 and not made a dime. I'm one of those. My team, FaZe Red in 2015, we went to losers, I think it was losers round two. And we made a 15-0 loser bracket run on Saturday to Saturday night, placing us in the losers finals to get us into Sunday and be top three. Envy in 2014 did the exact same thing, going from losers round one, tearing up the loser bracket, absolutely destroying it, to get to second, to get to the finals and get second. Whereas, oh, single elim, they're out round one. One day, one match, one series does not determine how good your team is. And that's the fact that we're using that concept and comparing it to other esports is the dumbest fucking thing. I'm so sorry, it is. Like, it makes no sense. I don't care what business models behind it, what sense it makes from a logistics standpoint, you're ruining the integrity of the game. Why? Why compromise that to fucking have a stream schedule be on time? Who fucking cares? I don't. I'm a competitor. Even as a viewer, like, I don't give a, I would rather the fucking stream go 9 hours late and see some awesome entertainment, some awesome Call of Duty action versus these teams that are coming back on this insane comeback story or doing this or that, than fucking sit here and watch, oh, well, Optic's out round one. They're done the entire time, really? Oh, let's look at Halo. EG versus CLG, the best two teams in the entire world are playing round one. One's gonna go on and make 250K and the other's gonna get $0? Oh, that makes sense. Yeah. Brilliant. Why didn't we think of this 5 years ago? Oh, because our game probably would have died then. Like, Optic AW champs, Optic versus Denial, matched up round one. Oh, just because fucking their pools messed up and one team upset another team, they matched up round one in the winners bracket. Denial beat them. Optic would have went home. If there was single elim, Optic would have been out of champs just because they lost one fucking series to the best team. That's dumb. There is literally no argument that can be made that makes single elimination a good idea in competitive FPS. Unless you're playing Counter-Strike. There's just none. In console FPS, Halo, Call of Duty, there's not one argument that can be made. And if you do, you're just making shit up. Because it's horrible. It's horrible for viewership. It's horrible to play. I've been on both sides. I watched all of Season 2 playoffs. It was as boring as could be. There wasn't anything I was excited to see. Not one part. Like, I would have been so excited to see Optic lose round one and come back in a, you know, even an 8-team double elimination bracket and come back and FaZe and meet up Optic versus FaZe and the loser bracket semis, and that'd be awesome to watch, you know? But no, all that's eliminated because we have in single elimination where we literally just, oh, a team lost? Well, let's set fire to that potential storyline. It's gone. Who cares? Oh well. On to the next. Oh, DT versus LG semifinals. Like what? No, DT versus LG winners semifinals. Those teams, yeah, they upset. Awesome. That's sick to see. But why the fuck are the teams they upset going home? They just got upset. That's what happened. You want to see them battle back. They got beat by a team they should have beat. Like, you want to see how they battle back. You don't just want to be like, oh, wow, well, see you in 3 months at the next event. You know? Single Nation needs to go. Needs to fucking go. There's not one argument that can be made. There's not one pro that can be said. Except, in my opinion, it keeps stream schedules on time. That's literally it. That's the only thing I can think of. And if that's what we're aiming for as our, you know, explosive year of Black Ops 3 and the CWL, then we're really doing something fucking wrong. That's just straight up. Okay, moving on. Let me think. Okay, yeah, let's talk about this year. This year has been trash. It's been said. I've said it. Every pro has said it. This has been the worst year of competitive Call of Duty I've ever competed in. Ever. And that's really saying something, considering this game, playing it 4v4, is really fucking good. Treyarch made a really good game. And this year was the worst year. Now, is it all Activision's fault? No. Is it all MLG's fault? No. Is it ESL's fault? No. Is it UMG's fault? No, not entirely, no. Definitely not. However, Activision did plan for this schedule, this CWL schedule, this not that many events schedule, this everything about 2016 being COD champs. Like, that's stupid. I'm sorry. Our entire year should not be based around one weekend. We have an entire year with a sick game where millions of different storylines, okay, obviously not millions, multiple storylines can be told throughout the year, and we're doing it this way. Like, online is necessary. That's fine. I don't care about the league. The league was fine. Sure, I don't mind it. But the fact that we had an 8-team invite-only Totino's LAN, where we played really, really bad rule sets. We had a qualifier with no prize. You didn't even finish the tournament. That was the silliest thing. We go into UMG South Carolina. People thought it was going to be a really good event. But let's keep in mind, that's in February. So our first real event, games dropping in November. Our first real event isn't happening until Valentine's weekend. February 12th, I believe. 12th through the 14th. So, f 3 months? 3 months in? Oh, no, four. Almost four, right? I guess it's like 3.5. 3.5 months in, we're having our first real event. Bam! Sony DualShock Bluetooth shits the bed. The entire event ruined. Because Sony's controllers can't work in a massive LAN environment. Awesome. Sick. Anyone's fault? Other than Sony's? No. No, probably not. But it still fucking happened. I mean, like, you could take many events in history and say, you know, is it this person's fault? Do I blame this person? No, but it happened. It still sucks. It still shits on the fact that, well, that event's out of the bag. Okay, moving on. Season one playoffs. Sure, I guess it was a good event. Yeah, I mean, ESL operated really well. It went well. Optic beat Ryze in a best of seven last map, round 11. That was pretty sick to watch. Okay, sure. One event. That was in April, I believe. Early April. So our first real actual event was 6+ months into the game. Awesome. the year that was supposed to be, quote, the year, the best year Call of Duty's ever seen, we haven't had one event until 6 months in. That's pathetic. That's honestly, as a fan, as a player, as an org owner, like, not that I'm these things, but if I was those things, I would be fucking pissed. I would be. That's just pathetic. That can't happen. That just can't happen. Moving on. Next event, next real event is Anaheim. Okay, so to counteract the very shitty Bluetooth Sony has, currently, we use Cronus Max, I believe MLG did. It's the keyboard adapter for the PS4, where it disabled Bluetooth and made the DualShocks a direct input into the PlayStation. Good idea, smart. However, I feel it was a little rushed. It definitely worked. I mean, I was there. Definitely, there was no Bluetooth issue. But I don't think overall it was set to perfection, and that's not something I could expect MLG to do. There was input lag, plain and simple. Some people noticed it on some stations, some didn't on others. Whether that's a Cronus Max product or MLG not making sure they're all the same, I don't know. But it was still an issue, okay? That sucks because that takes away from the event. When there's any issue at all, and I don't blame anybody on MLG. I don't really think it's their fault at all. They were like, this entire year is literally doing the best with what we can. And I know I'm going to sound like the most unappreciative, like, dick saying this, but when you're hyping this year up to be what it is, and it ends up being making the best out of a shitty situation, that really sucks for everybody involved. I don't care who you are. If you barely watch tournaments, like, it still sucks. You can't get your fix on the one tournament you want to watch because there's an issue. No matter what, big or small, there's issues. And I'm not, I mean, I'm not someone who thinks everything's going to be perfect or everything should be, but I don't know. Anaheim operated decently. It was a good event in terms of getting the job done. And you know, I commend MLG and everyone, even the Activision team, whoever worked on fixing that, you know, good job, but it was still not what it should be, right? It's still not adequate. Fair competition for everyone. And I say that because Royalty, any player, Royalty's an example, plays on like 10-10 sensitivity. He got really shit on by the fact that there was input lag in the controllers. That, we had no warning, okay? We just came into the event, bam, this is what we're working with. We apologize. It's just how it is. Well, why did I come? You know, it sucks. So, anyway, moving on. Next event, Stage 2 Finals. I think Anaheim had 100K viewers around. I mean, optics in the finals, so you accredit them to like 80%, 70% of that, okay? Season 2 Finals, optic loss round 1, first match, game 1, done, out, gone the whole weekend. Phase, game 2, done, out, gone the whole weekend. So, these two massive organizations that have massive fan base of a lot of people who love Call of Duty and follow their players, gone. Don't care. And this is what I mean by storylines and rivalries and the fact that Call of Duty is based on players and not the game. And I'm not saying any of it's Optic or FaZe's fault or any of these massive orgs. Like, it's not your fault, obviously. Like, you're an org. You're developing a fan base. But the fact is, your team lost, your players lost, you're out, and the people that watch your players and watch your team do not care to watch the rest of the event. They don't. And that's always been how Call of Duty is. And not all of them. Obviously, there's some people who love competitive Call of Duty. And if you're one of those people, awesome. Good. It's awesome to see, you know? But to be being a realist here, I know 80% of you watch to watch that player, to watch Skump, to watch Krim, to watch Karma, watch Formal, watch your favorite players. And that's how it is. That's how it's always been. Does it need to change? Maybe. Is it gonna change? Probably not. If it did change, great. It's not something you expect to change, though. I mean, that's based. For it to change, then, Call of Duty needs to be some super fun, action-packed game that people just cannot stop watching. But it's never really been that way. It's a hectic game. It's hard to follow sometimes. You want to see your players go off. That's just how it's been. It's been watching your players, watching your favorite players. And games, other games aren't like that. I watch CS. I'm an avid Counter-Strike event watcher. I have multiple favorite pros on multiple different teams. Do I watch Counter-Strike to follow those players, follow those teams? No. I watch Counter-Strike because it's really enjoyable to watch. Call of Duty is not the same to me. Never has been. To play is different, but to watch is just not. It's fun to watch. I get Call of Duty. I played a lot. I understand it. It's fun to watch players do certain things. It's not necessarily fun to watch the game itself. So yeah. Anyway, this year, Season 2 playoffs, 30K, I think. So we went from Anaheim like 100 plus to Season 2, the entire after round 2 matches. Round 2 to finals was like 30K and below, hovering. Dropping, dropping, jumping, dropping, jumping. Not good. It should not be like that. Should be better. Would double elimination help that? Yeah, definitely. Even if Optic lost twice, even if FaZe lost twice, like, our viewership overall throughout the weekend is automatically better because those teams get to play again. And hey, let's say FaZe make this insane loser bracket run. They come back, they beat Optic in semifinals losers, they come back to finals, they're in the finals, holy fuck, let's watch. Like, they're on this insane losers bracket win streak. Like, I wanna watch just to see if they can complete it. You know? It's a story. It's wanting to see, if they can do something like that. Yeah, so we went into this year thinking it was going to be the greatest year. There was going to be so we were being told so many awesome things, we were given these insane ideas of, oh, this year is the year. It's going to be like no other year. You have no idea what's coming. Just wait and see. Blah blah blah. We got, there's a potential that there's going to be in-game items. There's a potential there's going to be this and that, and a potential of crowdfunding, and a potential of this, and a potential of that. It's all these rumors and speculations that's happening about this year, and then nothing. It's July 18th. It is now 9 months into Call of Duty Black Ops 3, and there's been nothing that was promised to us as players. It's nothing. And that sucks, That's really pathetic. I'm somebody who I would rather know I'm not gonna get anything than be told I'm gonna get something and it not happen. I would rather like know and accept disappointment from day one than be lied to. Hold on. Actually, I have a very I tweeted about it. I'm actually gonna play it for you guys on stream. Here, give me 1 second. See if I can get it set up. I tweeted about it. This would have been to give you an idea of a timeline. This was March 21st, so this was almost what 4 months ago. Yeah, this is almost exactly 4 months ago. This is what I tweeted. So think about it. Think about 4 months ago. I felt this way because I was obviously being told something that wasn't happening. A lot of players were, not just me, I'm sorry. A lot of players were being told something that was gonna happen, and it didn't. 4 months ago, guys. And let's take a quick peek of what I'm talking about.
We have been hoodwinked, bamboozled, led astray, run amok, and flat out deceived. We have been.
I don't think anyone says it better than st than him, That is so far this year. For players and fans alike. And it's shitty, It's a shitty feeling knowing that, like, this was supposed to be the year and it turned out being nothing, It really sucks. Because that was 4 months ago that we were pissed off that we heard what we heard. And what made us even more pissed, I'll just give you some insight as far as pro players, is when we did get outraged, when we did get mad, when we got pissed off, we were basically being told, like, no. What we're saying or what we're promising is still coming. Just wait. And it's like, we were being told to wait 2 months prior to this, which I think this is in March. Now we're in March and, you know, we're being told to wait till this month, and now this month is supposed to be this month. And now it's to the point where we're just not even talking about it. Like, it's not being brought up. It, you know, it's over. Stage 2's over, right? Like, CWL is over. It's no more. There's nothing else left except champs. So there's like, nothing else coming. So at this point, you just feel like, oh, they're not going to entertain us now, you know? Like, it's just, it's over. But, it's kind of shitty. Because you thought, like, everything was going to happen this year, and you were being told it was, and it's just, it didn't. It's haven't. And, you know, I don't know if I'm going to get in trouble for giving you, like, insight on what we were being told and stuff. And I obviously can't go into specifics because I signed an NDA. But for the most part, I think you understand what I'm saying. Like, there was a lot of things that were happening, should have happened, could have happened, might have happened, that just ended up not happening. And basically, in lack of a better word, we just got lied to. Is it their fault we got lied to? No. Some people were saying things they thought were going to happen, that they thought were coming, that they were being told probably would have came, and it had to go into legal and everything else, and, you know, whatever. But at the end of the day, none of that matters to the fact that we were still being told something. Everyone's being told something, not just, like, fans. There was players and everything, anticipating crowdfunding and all these awesome, super nice perks that would make our year even better. That just didn't come. And that's pretty shitty. And I'm actually bring something up. I had a conversation with somebody who's involved in Call of Duty, heavily involved. And basically what they told me was, like, the fact that MLG had all these events in the past set, like, this standard for how Call of Duty is supposed to be done. And that's like such a horrible idea, and it's so bad. It's like, well, not really. I mean, for everything that I had, like, bad with MLG, like, all the bad blood we had and went through and whatever. And, oh, by the way, I still think MLG TV was the dumbest thing. I think it really shit on Call of Duty for a year. Do I think it was supposed to? Do I think they thought it was going to be that way? No. But it really did hinder us a lot. And that goes back to Activision getting, or MLG getting exclusivity and everything going into it. And just, I believe Nate Shots, like, said, like, him leaving Twitch and, you know, forcing basically every pro player to switch to MLG TV as well, like, that shit on us. As far as I can, it split our community. It really put us in a bad spot, and we obviously had to recover from that. But regardless, that's in the past. But back to what I was saying is, like, he said, like, MLG having all these events, like, set such a, like, a bad precedent for Call of Duty, like, how it's being thought about. It's just like, oh, everyone expects, like, all these events now. And it's, well, I mean, regardless, like, there's only been 6 events, and most of them were pretty bad. Majority of them were pretty fucking bad. There wasn't many positives to be taken. And that just, I don't know, that pissed me off. Because it's like, what, you just want to have, like, 2 events, single limb, and just, oh, well, sick, that's our year. Like, no, that's so boring. I loved having 15 events in a year. Whether it was financially good for those companies doing it, probably not. I loved it, though. It was awesome. There was so much to be at, like, done and said and played, and so much to go into it. I don't know. This year was just very shitty. Do I think it's going to end strong? Yeah, it will. I think champs will be sick. Regardless of all these issues, I think champs will, no matter what, be sick. Okay, here's another thing. Our game basically in September, what, 2-4, right? That's champs. It's called, well, September 2-4, later Call of Duty Black Ops 3, there's no more. I mean, there might be, what, one event at the end, but then it's like, well, by that time, like, the beta for the new game's out, right? Like, who really cares? It's kind of, champs already happened. That's our whole year. That's, there's no more league matches, no more CWL, there's no nothing. It's just, well, bye. See you in 2.5 months for the new game. Like, the scheduling was just horrendous. Absolutely horrendous. It's like they just didn't give a fuck, and they just threw shit down on a calendar and said, YOLO. Let me think. Sorry. I have some more things I want to bring up. Sorry. Let's see, where was I? Oh, okay. So, the way this year was set up, the CWL format, it forced a lot of players out. TP, Merc, Replays are obviously the three most notable, but there's a lot of other players that is not on that list that just got forced out. Because if you weren't in the CWL this year, if you weren't in the CWL Pro Division this year in your region, you got shit on. I feel so bad for you. Like, that sucks. That really fucking sucks, because there's a lot of good teams out there. There really is. There's a lot of sick teams that are better than a lot of teams. I'm sure there was plenty of teams that were better than the 100 Thieves roster in Season 2 that were way more deserving of a Season 2 league spot that just had no chance at all. That can't happen. We had two leagues that were like 2 months long, something like that. And the relegation process was just very meh. There's one relegation to see who gets out of Season 1 and into Season 2. And I think three teams came back, right? Two came back and two got relegated. And one of the teams, like, there was a passport issue and one couldn't play. And, like, that's obviously not... I'm sorry I said that, because that's basically irrelevant. But this year just shit on everyone. Except for, you know, those 12 CWL teams. And I'm going to bring something up, and this might not be something good to bring up, but the CWL, and I'm 100% going to say this, the CWL, the league itself, the stream, it benefited the fucking four CODcasters more than any other player. And that's pathetic. And, you know, Maven, X, Jack, Revan, I love all you guys, and I don't think bad of any of you, but how this year was set up, and it's obviously not in your control at all, you guys benefited. You guys got more on stream time than any player or any team ever. You guys grew massive fan bases. Like, literally, this year has been more about you guys than any, and that's not me being like egotistical or conceited or anything. Like, it's literally known by a lot of people. Like, you guys benefited more than any of us. And that's just silly. I'm not hating on you guys. I'm proud and very happy for all of you. But, like, just to give some insight on, like, how this fucking year has been. Like, that's it. And that's fucking stupid. League matches, I guess we're okay. Like, whatever. Online leagues, they're very necessary for how we have to set up our year, but, like, yeah, I mean, that just doesn't make any sense. And a lot of the rulings that happen, a lot of the, you know, the banning, the fining, the suspensions that went down were just, I guess, necessary, right? But a few were just over the top. Silly. Seemed very, We're gonna do it because we can. Like, and that should never be a thing. Or a league. But, trying to think. I had some other points I wanted to bring up. And I've made, this is already 50 minutes. I hate to go longer, but like, I want to make sure I say everything. Because I don't want to say it, like what I've said, and you know, do a 50 minute video, and then five ideas come to me when I end recording. I'm just like, well, fuck, I'm not doing another one. This is going to be no editing. This is 100% raw, recorded and uploaded. I know most of you probably would have preferred me to do like a vlog, but I didn't, and I can't really go back and do it now. Also, what I'm showing in this video is I enjoy the Black Ops 3 movement, but and even the new movement system in general. I don't mind jetpacks. What I mind is the fact that I can wall run and get way up here. Like, this shouldn't be able to happen. I mean, this is what makes it where people complain. This is where it, like, becomes a problem. When I can do things like this and get this high and jump out like this. And, I mean, AW had the dashing, you know, the side-to-side, back jump, forward, whatever, dash, like, this game has the wall running. It's a cool feature, but it hinders competitive because competitive Call of Duty has always been about lanes, and when you're watching a lane, I don't think I really showed on this map, but you're watching a lane, let's say I'm right here, and there's this entire wall behind me, right, and everything is a wall block off, and I'm watching a lane, but someone could come from up here, do some wall run, get super high, jump over the wall, and shoot me in my back. It takes away from the competitive aspect of, and I know, I don't even know why I'm starting this, because it's going to start some big, oh, adapt, like, this is the new way, like, blah, blah. Sure. But it takes away the competitiveness. It adds that even more of the fluky element. This jetpack, this thing, this movement bar, I think is awesome. This movement's fine. I don't mind jumping, double jumping, any of this, but wall running and then double jumping, that's what makes it bad. But anyway, that's pointless to even talk about. But anything else, let me try and put it in conclusion. I just don't think this year was done well, good, proper. I think it was just kind of thrown together, really. There wasn't enough planning gone into it. It's just kind of like, oh, we're going to get into esports. We're going to try this. We're not really going to care if we fuck it up, though. And that's kind of how I felt this year has just been. And I don't mean to say that in like a mean way, because I'm sure there's a ton of people at Activision on the esports team. A ton of people at ESL who care and really, really want to see this thing blow up and do really well. But bottom line is, this year so far has been extremely, extremely, extremely shitty. Yeah. Single elimination needs to go. Doesn't belong in our esport. Doesn't belong in our game. Doesn't fit the way our game plays and works. Especially with this new ban and protect feature. Single elimination is a horrendous idea and should be removed indefinitely unless you're doing some small single, like, 8-team invite like a Gfinity did back in 2013, like 2014. They ran their events a very cool way, and throwing a few of those in there is awesome. You know, it makes sense. Pool play in a single elim, you know, for like an invite only event where it's just you're gonna show up and we're going to treat you like all-stars, and then we're going to have some cool event like this. Sick. But when you're playing for, like, all this money, you're going to these millions of dollars, or I think it's, what, $2 million guarantee is what the poster says, whatever, event, and I could potentially play and lose in the first round because someone banned Fast Hands and made the game really fluky and weird, or just an example, you know? I talked to Clayster, Killa, or not just Killa, I'm sorry, DT, target banned Phase really well. It was awesome to see, right? Awesome. Cool. You used the ban protect really well. Was DT 100% the better team On that day, yeah, they were. 100%. They beat them fair and square. Does FaZe deserve 8th place? Because they got beat by one team who threw them off one game? No. Zoptic? No. Are they an 8th place team? No. And that's... I hate people who say, like, oh, it was an upset. Like, that's what happens. No. It's not what happens. Like, any other day, Optic would go in loser's bracket and probably come back and get top 2. Top 3. Not 5th through 8th because of a format issue. Like, it's silly to even think about. And yeah, so double elimination needs to return. We've seen our biggest peaks and our best competitions and events in that format, and I think there's a reason for it. Another thing is, bro, COD players, dude, you're on the top, man. Not everybody can be the goddamn hero. Not everyone can be the saint, you know? It's fucking boring. Like, no one wants to see, oh, well played, guys. Good job. See you next time. From both sides. Like, maybe after, sure. But before, like, oh, yeah, we're going back up against Optic Gaming. You know, they're the best team in the world. They're fantastic. I love all of them. See if my team can put up a good fight. Well, I mean, like, before the map start, I'm already like sleeping in the Banner Protect. Like, it's just like Call of Duty's always been based on these sick rivalries, these sick competitions, these awesome, you know, fan bases where, yo, Aghs fans and Nadeshot fans are going at each other, blah blah blah. Like, is Nadeshot finally gonna beat Aghs and talk and get all his revenge? Like, that's so much more fun to watch than, oh well, We got JCap versus Crim6. Let's get him in a pregame interview. Hey guys, how do you think the match is going? Oh, you know, Envy's a great squad. They just won season 2. We're gonna do our best. Yeah, Optic's been consistent all year. Hope we can put up a good fight. All right, well guys, see you. Best of luck in your match. See you at the end. It's just like, I guess, but that's not gonna, you know, have like 200k events where. And I'm not by any means tooting my own horn or anything, but the FaZe versus Optic rivalry that we had in the beginning of AW, I know people are just going to say, oh, you're living in the past, man. Like, nah, it's facts, man. Like, that was a sick rivalry. And I just so happened to you know, cut my hand or whatever and have my injury. I'm not even going to say this word. Injury. And yeah, it led to some awesome story. And whether I won or lost, like, that event would have been fucking awesome. You know, and I'm not saying like, oh, there needs to be some sick injury. It's just like, there needs to be some story, in Call of Duty, or it gets very stale because our fans are used to this storylines, multiple, you know, and there's got to be something. Otherwise, it's just, well, I mean, you know, fucking Machine is hilarious. Like, he's literally carrying the stream in a sense, or Courage is doing some wacky thing in a fucking all-star match. Like, that's going to get us 10k more viewers than it would otherwise. We're not going to survive like that. And I'm just so sick of hearing, like, so sick of hearing that, like, everything's coming and this year's going to be the year and what next year is going to be fucking awesome. It's just like, shit needs to happen, you know? It's just, I'm done with being told. And I don't think I just speak for myself when I say that, but this video's gone on an hour, and I've fell off the mat 4 times running around. Yeah. So, I think I brought up everything almost that I had to say. Trying to think if there's anything else before I turn it off and upload. Sorry if this went on way longer. I should probably have made it into like a series thing or something, but if you stuck around for the entire hour to hear this out and watch and listen and hopefully get some insight on how I thought about this year and how other people thought about this year and whatever. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you all for watching. What? Thank you for listening if you did. I might just disable the comments for this video. Might not. I honestly, I mean, I've never been one to not let someone speak. Because I definitely want to hear your opinion, even if I don't agree with it. Which I probably want if you think single elimination is a good idea. Anyway, this year so far has sucked, period. I want to see the best for Call of Duty. I really do. And I think it starts with making the correct decisions, you know, working as a team and not just being so damn segregated where we're just being told shit from one side and having to do it no matter if we agree or like or want or what. And that just needs to stop. I don't know what's necessary to get to that point, but something's got to change. Anyway, guys, it's been fun. It's been real. Hadn't been real fun, but I will see you guys next time in the next video, the next stream. Thank you so much for watching. I'm sorry it went on for so long. Hope I gave you a little insight on this year. And yeah, take it easy. I was just thinking about it. It is July, and there has only been 2 real events, and one I didn't even compete in. And last year I competed in 15. The year before that I had like 13. The year before that I had like 9. But we saw growth all those years, and then this year we just saw a massive downfall on the best year. Anyway, Kai XP's coming up. That's going to be sick no matter what. Tune in. Watch your favorite players. Try to watch the game even if your favorite team's out. And yeah, I will see you guys next time. Peace out, guys.